It's really hot out here. I'm struggling to keep up with the watering. That's neither here nor there. That's not the point of this video. As soon as I'm done filming this, I'm going to water again. It's 7 o'clock at night, so it'll be the third time today. Hey, what's up, garden friends? Jeff here. How's everybody doing? You're doing well. I'm great. Turbo says hi. Hi, Turbo. You say hi to everybody. Such a good boy. I'm in the midst of filming last week's video, or not last week, so the video prior to this one. And in that video, I'm watering, moving some palms around, and start messing with the fertilizer, and then I've just cut that off because I just didn't feel like going into a whole entire spiel about fertilizing in another vlog. And I realized, hey, you know what? Let's just make a quick video about the fertilizers I'm using, why I'm using them, and what I like about them. So that's just out there, and I don't have to talk about it every single time I'm fertilizing out here in a vlog, and those longer vlogs that come out on Saturdays. So for starters, just getting right into it, there are two continuous release, three actually, continuous release fertilizers that I've been using and I really like. And then I have switched from using an all-purpose to just using a petunia feed, which is down here. It's in here. I can get it out. There's the petunia feed, the Jack's petunia feed. I've talked about this a lot. And there's the third of the continuous release fertilizer. This is a water-soluble fertilizer, so something you'd use in a hose and sprayer. I'm using an injector system now. I've only been using it for probably maybe 2 weeks at this point, and I do really like it. So what that is, it's one of these Chapin dispersers that goes on here. I think it's the 4702. Let's see if I can pull it out. I'm gonna come around. Can you see it? Is there a model number? Yeah, 4702. Water goes in there. I have a hose connected right here that runs down to the hose reel, and then when I switch that on, the water that comes out of the hose already has fertilizer, and it's mixed in at 1 ounce per gallon. That's not always going to be appropriate. The watering more frequently, fertilizing at a lower dose is a really good idea. I like to fertilize at lower doses more frequently as opposed to going in, you know, maybe what, every 2 weeks, once a month with a higher dose of fertilizer. Having a continuous feed just helps get more sturdy and consistent growth out of the plants. But there's nothing wrong with the hose and sprayer. Use them for years. This is a whole new setup for me. It's only been a couple weeks, so we'll see how that even goes. This is what I use in there. The petunia feed, I really like this one. It's not your typical like 20-20-20 all-purpose fertilizer, but I do use it on basically everything out here like I would an all-purpose fertilizer. And that's because a lot of the plants I grow require different fertilizers to an extent. So the palms need more metals in their fertilizers. The hibiscus specifically, they want a good amount of potassium in their fertilizers. You look thirsty too. Or maybe it's just because it's night and the flowers are closing up. I don't need to go off on all that. I'm going to be watering here in a minute. We already talked about that. Potassium, important for those hibiscus and important for the plants in general. It's a really good thing to have higher levels of potassium in the fertilizer. I like calcium and magnesium as well. Those are good to have present because they help build nice, strong plants. Potassium helps facilitate nutrient uptake as well as just more sturdiness in the plants. And there are a fair amount of research, not a ton, but there are some studies that I've been able to find showing that having appropriate potassium levels, not high, appropriate levels of potassium levels do help a lot with winter survivability with plants. So something like my needle palms over here, it's very important that they get those higher levels of potassium. I always try and make sure that I'm hitting these with a hibiscus fertilizer around July and do that July, August, September to help get them ready for winter, and then I cut off on it, right? Because you don't want to keep fertilizing them and then have the cold weather roll around. That can kill the plants. The petunia feed, it's got all the good stuff in it. So I'm getting my potassium. It's got the metals in there. It has the iron to help keep things nice and green when it comes to the foliage on the plant. And it has that potassium. Already has the 20% nitrogen, just like you would have on a regular all-purpose fertilizer. And the phosphate's only 6%. So phosphate, that is something that there are a lot of fertilizers out there push when it comes to blooming, getting plants to bloom, especially on something like those hibiscus over there. But the problem is when you have too much phosphorus in the fertilizer, you can start to have nutrients binding up and you end up with a lot of yellowing on the leaves. And yes, they can help promote blooms, but just having a good fertilizer that's appropriate for the plant, like a hibiscus, should give you good enough blooms as it is. That's when I use the Nelson's. I've only been using this one for this year so far, but I've been liking it. Typically, I have been using a slow release from Hidden Valley Hibiscus, but I needed something more quickly, so I thought I'd give this a try, and I'm liking it so far. The breakdown on this one goes 10, 4, 12. So you can see it's lower numbers, but it's the same difference where you have your nitrogen, low phosphorus, higher potassium. And that's fine. That's good. Since it's a slow release, don't need the high numbers on there. A soluble fertilizer is something that I like to use more frequently because it gives the plants a fast feed, right? You water that in and they're going to take that up. Whereas a continuous release, whether it's one that is heat activated or water soluble, they take a lot longer to get down into the systems of the plants. So for hibiscus, when it comes to slow release, I do prefer this one. And then with the other slow releases, they are more specific, but I really could mix it up and use them for a lot of different applications. So this one right here, it's very full and very heavy. This is the Great Palm or Perfect Palm fertilizer. I'm using this year as an alternative. This guy, he's trying to lick my face when I'm trying to talk about this. I'm using this year as an alternative to the Palm Game. Palm Game's great, but it gets really pricey. Not that this is cheap. It's not cheap. But this one is made to be used more frequently, so you can spread it out about once a month, and it has a fairly similar appearance. I don't think I'm getting that off. It doesn't really matter. You don't need to see what the actual fertilizer looks like. You need to see the breakdown. You can see this is going to be big on the metals, especially making sure that it has the manganese, the iron, the copper, the boron, and it has the calcium, which I really like because, as I mentioned, calcium, magnesium, very important for the plants. So that is the only one that's really specific. So that is just for the palm trees. It's not going to hurt to give to the other plants, but I mostly have it for the palms. I have a lot of palms out here, and I'm just putting that down every month. I just take it and sprinkle it on top of the soil. My hose has enough pressure that it blends in pretty well on its own when I give it a nice watering. And I also make sure that the plants have been pre-watered when I do that, so I'm not just flushing everything right out. Same thing with the water soluble. I should have mentioned that. Make sure your plants are watered first, right? If they're bone dry and you hit them with a fertilizer, a lot of it's going to come rushing out the base of the pot. And also, you could burn the roots on the plants because that's a lot of shock and nutrients just have that hit them really hard out of nowhere. And then in here, it's just a great bucket. You don't need to see what's in the bucket. It's just the Jax Classico. I like it a lot. It's a good all-purpose fertilizer. The breakdown on that Jax Classico is 15, 8, 23. So 15 nitrogen, 8 on the phosphorus, and then 23 for the phosphorus. No, potassium. Right. Sorry, got a little tongue-tied there. 15, 8, 23. It has the iron in there, and it's made to be more stable, which is, that's really just there when they say that, that it's not going to be as affected by pH of the water or the soil, and that's going to help promote more green in the plant, because when you have shifts in the pH or you just have an improper balance, whether it's the soil or the water or both of those things, then you end up not having appropriate nutrient uptake. And that is supposed to remedy that problem to an extent. But again, those numbers, 15, 8, 23, that breakdown's fairly similar to basically everything else except for the palm fertilizer, where they have a good amount of nitrogen, just a little bit of the phosphorus, and plenty of the potassium, making nice, strong, healthy plants that should bloom well on their own just because they're nice and healthy. Not all that into the bloom boosters, but it's something you can use, but I would check your dosages on those just to be safe. You don't want to go overboard with those. I guess there are exceptions, like plumeria. Sometimes I have to hit those with a booster when I'm growing plumeria because I just don't quite have the sun form to get them to bloom. And the orange bird of paradise too. I don't quite have the sun form, so I have to hit them with something to help stimulate that bloom cycle on them. And that usually works pretty well. But like I said, it comes with a lot of drawbacks. You got to be careful with it. There are, of course, lots of other things that I like to use that I wouldn't necessarily consider fertilizers. There could be some debate around that, but things like seaweed extracts, dried kelp, bat guano, earthworm castings, where they are a fertilizer, but first there needs to be a process to help break those down, to release those benefits and to feed the nutrient to the plant, right? Feed is not really the right word. They're not eating the stuff. They're taking it up through their roots, but you get my point there. Those are things that I consider a soil additive. Bat guano and earthworm castings, maybe not so much, because in the long run, something needs to be broken down and it's going to be a more slow release, even slower than a slow release fertilizer, though, or a continuous release is what manufacturers are preferring everybody to call them now, because slow release confuses people and continuous release makes it sound like every time you water, you're giving your plant some fertilizer, which is true as long as it's one that's water soluble. I also, with my continuous release fertilizers, if it says that you need to apply it every 6 months, I usually do it every three. If it says to do it every 3 months, I'm probably going to reapply every single month during the active growing season. Do I need to talk about that appropriate fertilizing time? Okay, we'll do it. The fertilizing, specifically when I like to do it, is going to be probably, I would say, late March, depending on the plant, all the way up until September. And after that, I slow down and back off of it with the plants that are in the ground. With my house plants, if they are things that are going to be going into my growth space where it's nice and warm and they're going to stay in active growth, then sometimes I'll go ahead and keep on fertilizing them all year. As long as they're pushing out growth and moving, you can fertilize them. But if your home is cool, or maybe you don't have a lot of lighting and your plants are just chilling, you know, for a few months when those day lengths are a lot shorter and you're not having to water as often, I probably wouldn't fertilize either. It's one of those things where you sort of just have to gauge it as you go. And then I have one other fertilizer that I like to use that's just a homemade fertilizer. It's kind of like a growth bomb that I don't have the exact numbers for memorized, which I should, because I've been using this and doing this for like 15, 20 years. But it's beer, Epsom salt, ammonia, and water, and you dilute it heavily. But man, it really gets the tropicals growing. The elephant ears and the bananas go nuts with that stuff. So that's to be used sparingly, because the accumulation of the salts and everything, it can cause some problems. But it's been a great fertilizer when I've used it. So you comment down below, let me know if you want that recipe, and I'll see if I can dig it up. I can dig it up. It's in my phone somewhere. I'm going to make some up in probably a week or so, because I haven't done it yet this year, and I like to start doing that in May. I'm pretty far behind with the fertilizers, at least the homemade fertilizer, that is. And that one, really, it is specifically for palm trees, but I don't see why that would matter. I think it's an old Jerry Baker. Y'all remember Jerry Baker? I think it's an old Jerry Baker recipe from a long time ago, and it's worked great. It really gets things moving with the palms, but it's not something I would use all of the time because it's pretty intense. Doesn't really jive with my slow and steady method that I like to do with the 1 ounce per gallon distribution with that shape and thing. Okay, that's all. I feel like I covered the four fertilizers that I use the most, which is going to be that petunia feed, the hibiscus, the grape palm, which so far I am liking, and then the Jex Classicoat. I like that Jex Classicoat. I get greener foliage with it than I do with a lot of other all-purpose slow-release or continuous-release. That's what I'm supposed to say. Get better green on my annuals when I mix it in around the pots. Oh, and this time of year, I didn't mention the Classicoat. I just put it down once a month when I do the grape palm. I just make sure to not go too heavily with either one of those so that I'm not shocking anything. You have to use an awful lot of those continuous release, at least the all-purpose ones, to really do much shock or damage to the plants. Comment down below what are some of your favorite fertilizers. You have some systems and some methods. I'm not going to be a fertilizer shamer. If you like Miracle-Gro, great. If it's working for you, no problem. Talking about fertilizer on a gardening channel can be polarizing, because there's people with some very strong opinions about the types of fertilizers that you should and should not be using. Go ahead and comment down below. You can disagree. I'm fine with that. Just letting you know what I'm using, what's worked, and why I like them. A lot more simple to use things that have a similar ratio with their NPK, so that I can use things fairly evenly across the board. I don't really have anything out here that needs anything all that specific, right? I'm not growing plumeria anymore, and I don't have a ton of cactus anymore. The tropicals, I mean, they're tropicals. The palms and the gingers and the heliconias, I think they all appreciate the decent level of nitrogen and the decent level of potassium and not being overly fed with the phosphorus. Like I said, let me know. What are some of your favorites? What have you been doing? What are your systems? Got any fun homemade recipes? Some brews? Love a good fertilizer brew. A nice compost tea. Nothing wrong with a compost tea. Hi, Kitson. So nice of the stalker to show up. She's so stinking cute. All right. As always, and most importantly, everybody, where's she going? She thinks she's hiding. Keep on growing. Bye-bye.